All right, I apologize for that. Hopefully, wait, give everybody just a second and have everybody join us. Let's see, all right, there's one eyeball. All right, got Catherine there. This should be working now, so. All right, very cool. And again, we'll just wait. I apologize for that. Again, I'm a rookie. I should know this stuff better. It looks like people are starting to join, so that's cool. And a little bit windy out here. I'll try to speak up. Hopefully that'll help. And there's zero traffic for me to be worried about, but you can kind of tell where I am right now. There's 18 Anson Street behind me. That's the city market. We've got St. Philip's Episcopal out there. There's the French Quarter Hotel. All kinds of good stuff. All right, we'll go ahead and get going. I appreciate everybody's patience with this. And again, I apologize for the technical difficulties. I had the phone sideways. I don't know what was going on with it, but I had it right. Today, we're gonna discuss a few things having to do with our headquarters here. We're gonna talk about architecture. We'll talk a little bit about history. We'll talk about preservation and then ghosts as well, or at least a ghost story. But I want to tell you a little bit about this house, which is our headquarters. It's you can see it, it's a Charleston single house. And single house is the predominant form of architecture that you'll see in Charleston. And it gets its name, obviously, because it's one room wide, as you can see there. Most single houses are 2 to 3 rooms deep. You will see different sized single houses throughout town, but most of them look pretty similar to this one here. See, there's a porch, or as we refer to them as piazzas, on the front of the house. The piazzas typically face either south or they face west, and this is to capture the northeastern breezes up off the harbor. These homes were built way before air conditioning, so the piazzas were a place where the families would spend a lot of time. It was the coolest place in the house, was to actually be outside and to have those ocean breezes passing through the home. And then with the house being one room wide, it stayed ventilated a lot better than if it was 2 or 3 rooms deep. You go to other historical places in our country, you know, Philadelphia or Boston or New York City, and see some of the pre-revolutionary homes up there, and they're typically Georgian style, you know, central hallway, large rooms on either side, and then they go back much deeper. And that just wouldn't work in Charleston because of our climate here. One thing about single houses that throws people off a lot are these false doors that we have on the front of our bottom floor piazza. These are actually working doors. They were designed to give your guest a formal greeting up off the street, and then it gives you a little bit more privacy as well. But you can see here that the front door actually just leads onto the bottom piazza. And I remember when I first started giving tours a few years ago in 1991, and was explaining to one of my aunts that there were actually people in the world that referred to these as porches instead of piazzas. And she said, "John, there is actually a difference between a porch and a piazza." So I was like, "Well, I want to hear it." And she said, "You know, if you work hard all day and you come home and you have an ice cold Coca-Cola and you sit out here, that's a porch. But if you work hard all day and you come out here and you have, you know, a cocktail or ice cold beer, that's what makes it a piazza." And she said, "If you work hard all day and you come out here and you don't drink anything, well, that's a damn shame." But there's your difference between porch and piazza there. We're proud of our gates here. These were actually made by students at the American College of Building Arts. And I am going to attempt to flip this around so you can see it a little bit better. You can see the wrought iron work here. Wrought iron's different than the cast iron that you would see in like Savannah or New Orleans. And we're really proud of the wrought iron here in Charleston because it takes a more artistic talent than just pouring, you know, hot molten iron into a cast and then forming the shapes from there. This is actually wrought with a hammer to form the different shapes. And when purchased this house about 6 years ago, contractor said, "All right, I'm going to order the gates," and I asked where they were from, and they weren't even from the United States. And I said, "You know, we have an incredible, you know, not only an asset, but institution here in Charleston called the American College of Building Arts, and they actually teach their students, their artisans, how to do stuff like this, like make these gates. And you can actually get a four-year degree in blacksmithing or timber framing, stone carving, the different disciplines that, you know, were used to build this country and build the entire world. But anyway, when I purchased this house 6 years ago, it looked a lot different than it does now. It was referred to as an antique store. There goes the phone. Hopefully everybody's still there. It was referred to as an antique store. And anyway, it hadn't been renovated since Hurricane Hugo. So in it was 6 years ago, or 5 years ago, purchased this place, and it definitely needed a renovation. So new colors and new porch and new columns and things like that, and it turned out really well. But as many of y'all are aware, that before you can renovate anything, before you can build anything in Charleston, if it's 75 years or older, it has to be approved by the Board of Architectural Review, and it's their job to make sure that Charleston keeps their historical charm. And I know this camera is all over the place, and I apologize, I'm trying to juggle a couple of things here, but I want to show you something pretty cool that we're proud of here, and it's this plaque. It says Charalopolis, that's Latin / Greek for City of Charles, and you can see the award was originally given in 1981. That's when the house underwent its first renovation, preservation project, what have you. 1670, that's when Charleston was founded. And this is an award that's given by the Preservation Society to any building, any house that's been properly fixed up. And it was important for us to obviously stay within the Board of Architectural Guidelines. We are, you know, great stewards of Charleston, and that's what we do. We help raise money for historical landmarks. So we knew from day one when bought this place that we wanted to do it right. So using all the correct materials and the correct techniques to make it all happen. Unfortunately, the office is closed today, but we hope to open up in the very near future. I don't know, I'm hoping within the next couple weeks or so. We've been busy cleaning it and getting things squared away and sneeze guards and things like that, but we'll be here before you know it. All right, so that covers the architecture. It's a Charleston single house. The preservation, we got the Charalopolis Award again right after we did the renovation 5 years ago. Let's talk a little bit about the history of this building. It's not as old as a lot of places in Charleston. It actually dates back to 1894. Let's back up a little bit before that. In 1681, when the Lord's proprietors and the group of British English settlers arrived here, this area was known as Colleton Square. There was a creek right down here at Market Street. There was actually a creek, and the creek kind of came up this way, and where I'm standing now would have been part of Colleton Square, named after Sir Colleton. He was the one that King Charles gave this land to. In fact, Charleston had numerous squares and throughout the town, but they've since kind of been dissolved. And as Charleston has grown, those squares have gone away. Most of that happened in the 1700s though. But originally this was Colleton Square. This part of town, or actually back up Anson Street here, originally it was named Charles Street. It was named after Charles Pinckney. Him and his wife Eliza Lucas, they lived on the other side of this block here on East Bay Street, and Charles Pinckney was one of the signers of the Constitution. His wife, absolutely one of the most incredible people in Charleston's history. If you ever want to read about somebody super cool, I recommend Eliza Lucas Pinckney. She was incredible. But anyway, so this was Charles Street. It became known as Anson Street in the early 1800s. What we do know is that looking through the censuses and the documentation we could find of this property, that the land by the early 1800s was owned by a freed African-American, Mrs. Hampton. She evidently had won her freedom in a lottery of sorts. Eventually it would have been 1893, Mrs. Hampton sold this property to the McGrath family. They were from Limerick, Ireland, and they got When they moved into the house, they only had 2 children, and as time would progress, they actually had 7 kids living in this house. Now, this house isn't that big. It's right at 2,000 square feet, maybe like 2,100 at most, and they had 7 kids living here. And looking back, some of the census, I believe it was 1900 census or 1910, they actually had a boarder living in the house as well. So imagine 10 people living in this home right here. So Mr. McGrath, him and one of his sons, actually ran, really wasn't a blacksmith shop, it was a ferry shop. They made horseshoes right next door at 20 Anson Street, which is kind of cool because now it's home of Charleston Carriage Works. And yes, they still put shoes on their horses there. But the McGraths owned not only 20 Anson Street, but they owned 18 Anson Street as well. The blacksmith shop, the horse ferrying shop, actually stayed open several years even after the McGrath family moved in 1908. One thing I think is incredible about the McGrath family is, you know, they had 7 kids, and the oldest daughter, Catherine McGrath, she was trained at the Xavier School of Nursing here in Charleston, which would later become part of the Roper St. Francis Network, and it was taught by nuns. It was a Catholic school, obviously. And but in World War I, prior to that, she actually joined the Army Nursing Corps, and she became the head nurse of Walter Reed Hospital up in Washington, D.C., which I think is a really cool piece of history here at 18 Anson Street. 1908, they sold this property for $1,800 to James Satilli. Mr. Satilli was an Italian immigrant, and pretty interesting guy in Charleston's history. He was actually one of the original developers of Isle of Palms. He owned a bunch of the property out there, and he actually was the person that petitioned the city to build the first bridge over the Cooper River, which didn't happen until like 1939, but he's the person that made that happen. Let's see what I'm missing. So that era in Charleston's history, it was very different than these, you know, 4 or 5 star hotels and restaurants and high priced real estate that you see now. This area was very much a blue collar neighborhood. We're in the heart of, or kind of on the edges of Ansonboro right now. And Ansonboro was referred to as the borough, and it was a working class neighborhood. This area behind us here, the parking lot that used to be like a retail operation. They manufactured clothing, actually. It was more of a manufacturing facility. And then Clausen's Brewing Company, they made beer and alcohol and such down here. And they had a glass bottling operation, things like that. And then this parking lot that's behind me now, where that car is, that used to be a cotton warehouse. And the houses through here, most of them working class families, and then most of the commercial operations through here, they would have been everything from cobblers to again brewing operations and cotton mills and storage and warehouses and things like that. Very different than what we see now. Let's see, so 5 years ago, bought this place, renovated it, and this was about, I guess, the third or the fourth day here. We had one of our ghost tour guides came in, and she said, John, have you met Marjorie upstairs? I was like, I have no idea what you're talking about. Well, evidently, she had a gift and was able to sense the spirits that lived in this house, and we don't know anything about her other than her first name, which is Marjorie, and supposedly she occupies the top floor. You can see the top windows there, which is actually my office, and she was not very happy with what was going on. She alluded to the fact that there were quite a few women that were working here in this operation and just one guy. And as soon as I got word of that, I quickly ran upstairs and said, Marjorie, I'm John. I'm kind of your new house guest here, and we come here with, you know, great intentions. We run the best walk-in tour company in the entire world, and you know, we come here as friends, and we certainly don't want to upset you and all that. And she's been fine ever since, but you can talk to some of our staff that work downstairs, and they'll be the first to tell you that, you know, late at night when they know I'm not upstairs. They will they'll hear footsteps walking up and down. They'll hear different noises and things like that. So we try to be as respectful to Marge as we possibly can. Let's see what else. I brought some pictures. I think it's kind of crazy to mention them. One thing that I thought was interesting was 1976. This place sold for $15,000. It's worth a fair amount more, maybe $16,000, $17,000 at this point, but it's typical Charleston real estate. Let's see, this is headquarters of Bulldog Tours. We have the entire, the first floor and the second floor. In the back of the first floor is the tour guide lounge, where the best tour guides in the world hang out. Let's see, this is kind of the operations for where we are great stewards of Charleston. Most of y'all know that a big part of kind of our core values here at Bulldog is to make sure that we give back to our community, and we've partnered with various historical landmarks throughout town, and we get exclusive access to those locations, and then we help raise money for preservation. And all this started 19 years ago at the old Exchange building on the corner of East Bay and Broad Street. It was a handshake agreement, and from there it's just, you know, blossomed and been an incredible partnership. We did the same type partnership at the old city jail to help preserve that place, which is an incredible building. We do history and ghost tours there. The circular church on the corner of Meeting and Cumberland, that was our third partnership, and we've helped preserve the oldest graveyard downtown, which has been really cool. I've since partnered with Patriots Point, the Yorktown, the World War II aircraft carrier. We give ghost tours out there. And then certainly Magnolia Cemetery. Most of y'all have seen some of our videos out there. That was one of our newest partners there. But to date, in 19 years, we have raised over $4 million to help preserve these historical landmarks, which is really cool. And 18 Anson Street, this is where all the magic happens. This is where the best staff in the world, this is where we work. This is where all these ideas kind of happen, and we all hustle, and we absolutely love what we do every day of showcasing Charleston. We miss the heck out of all y'all, and we're anxious for y'all to get back to Charleston and come visit, which will hopefully be very soon. But with that, I am going to try to, one, not get ran over. It's actually a car. Those of you who know me know that I'm not the best multitasker, so I've got something in my hand right now, and there's no way I can answer a question if I have something in my hand. So, all right, let's see. All right, scrolling through here. Hey, Randy. Hey, Alan. Brian. Perfect. Kimberly, good to see you. Mary Hall, good to see you. Suzanne Wallace, one of my favorite people. Let's see, Janet Kennedy. Hey, David, let's see. Looking for questions. Hello from Oklahoma City. It's good to see y'all. My lovely wife is at home watching. Wendy, good to hear. Good to see you. She's out on Daniel Island. Married to one of the craziest people in town. Let's see. Thanks for doing these tours, blah, blah, blah. Definitely join this. No. Satilli owned, yeah, that's a true story. Any of you College of Charleston people, the Satilli house over there, right, one of the most incredible Victorian homes in all of Charleston. Yep, bulldogtours.com for gift cards. Please support the company, I agree 100%. Marjorie is definitely still around. That's from one of our ghost guides. And she freaks us out. She didn't freak me out, and I spend a lot of time with her. But anyway, enjoyed all the tour. The Citadel last week. Yeah, if you haven't seen the Citadel tour, that was really cool. Something I'm proud of. And Citadel, the mascot's the Bulldog, which is where the name came from. And kind of interesting, when I started all this, it was just a hobby, and I thought I'll be the only tour guide forever here. But it was a way to have fun, get back in the groove of giving tours, and honestly, to meet some girls. And it worked. I met my wife through giving tours here, and it turns out I'm not the only tour guide here. There's several other, about 50 of them out there. So anyway, hello from Knoxville, on and on. Anyway, if there's questions, y'all just put them on, and we'll answer them later on at some point. But Super proud of Bulldog Tours, super proud of what we've done to help preserve not only Charleston, but 18 Anson Street here as well. And super excited to see y'all back in town and let us show y'all the very best of Charleston out there. But with that, take care of yourselves. Come see us soon. And Godspeed. Take care now.